talk about retail a little bit this morning, as we're expected to hear from other wholesalers. We have Mike Reed here from Dow Jones. BJ's will report later on this morning. Mike is Deputy Managing Director at Dow Jones Newswires, and Jim Frischlinger, you see there, from New Oak Capital, where he's president and founder. All right, Mike, let me start with you on Costco. A little bit below expectations, but a pretty good sales number going up, same-store sales. I don't know. Do you read into this at all?
There had been a little bit of a trend of price pressure in some of the electronic goods, and that may be significant in the earnings number. But the sales number still, the revenue number looks higher than expected. But they have been at the better end of the retail segment, being the discounters, not just them, BJ's, Walmart, Sam's Club.
And we're trying to figure out if that trend is going to change at all. Jim pointed out last hour that Walmart last quarter was a little bit below expectations, and Costco continues that. We'll see what BJ's does. But the kind of macro trend in retail of the discounters, or these warehouse chains being the ones that people go to because the economy's still tough, I mean, is that still the story here, 2010, as it was in 2000, I guess, 8 and 9?
But I think discounting is clearly still the new black.
Right? Come on. When's that changing?
So Walmart suggested that. Costco this morning seems to suggest that. And curious to see what the other retailers are coming out. Big Lots coming out, I guess, as a closeout retailer might show some signs of life, given that that's actually in the that's in the area the consumer seems to be interested in, which is the best value for the dollar. But I still take away from these announcements that the consumer is still again, still relatively conservative.
I guess. It makes sense. I mean, what people are dealing with and the news flow that they have and the job situation. I mean, any sense, Mike, of what changes that? Where we are in the cycle that we're still having the same conversation?
Yeah, I think the consumer is still very much lukewarm. They're not struggling as they were a year ago, but they're certainly not in a position to be binging.
Is that just a different mindset? Is it kind of this quote unquote new normal, or are people waiting for something? I mean, what's going to be the thing that makes not that we're rooting for America to binge again. I mean, we all know we were out of control for years, but will that happen, or is it just the new normal?
Well, I think to some extent it's the new normal because there's a lot of reasons for the savings rate to remain high. Going forward, all sorts of reasons unrelated to the economy in terms of 401k. Healthcare.
I did think it was interesting in the last personal income and spending numbers we saw the savings rate at, I think it was 3.3%, which is the lowest since really right around the time the crisis began.
I don't think it's ever going to go back to where it was, because there's lots of reasons for middle class Americans to feel that they need to save more money. As I said, 401k pension contributions, healthcare benefits, companies are gradually offsetting more onto the consumer, onto the worker. They feel that they need to save more. They're worried about the economy. Unemployment is still not coming down. There's more reasons to save than to spend. So when you spend frugally, except when you see a bargain. So I think that trend will continue. Yeah. Whether or not it structurally changes the economy over a long period of time, that's an unanswered question.
Do you think it will, Jim? I mean, you think things are just different, plain simple, after this crisis?
Well, I do think the pendulum has shifted dramatically in terms of lending standards, in which case it's hard for anyone, any American, not to realize you're going to need some money down.
Sure.
So I do think there's a little bit of emphasis on a little bit of uptick in terms of thoughts about savings and certainly about being a little more frugal.
Sure.
So maybe we have a smarter consumer right now.
Well, I guess that you be careful what you ask for, but it has an effect on the economy, but it's probably better in the long term, as we've talked about before. All right, guys, thanks. 7 after the evening. For an instant on it this morning, Mike Reed, Dow Jones, Jim Frischling, New Oak Capital, both with us in studio in New York. So Bunning made his point, and the bill still passed overwhelmingly. What do you make of what's happened the last few days?
I think he really, really picked. His intentions may have been correct, the notion of paying for what you are spending, but he
jobless
really
benefits
picked
in
the
a
wrong
down economy.
One. Yeah, and even the Republicans, I think, were embarrassed by it in the end, and he's also a lame duck, which made it a little bit easy for him to do. It would have been interesting to see whether he would have done it if he wasn't. It was just the wrong bill to object to. It affected millions of people.
Yes.
It is politically, tone deaf. So I think his protest will be remembered as more of an embarrassment than anything else. The overall concept is the correct one. The rein in spending, make sure you can budget for it. But this was really not the bill to be making that point on.
I wonder if the point will be remembered, though, at all, Jim, that, hey, on other things, if it's not something like an extension of unemployment benefits and of struggling economy for people who are out of work, will that concept of pay as you go be remembered, or will we see any kind of shift in the way the government looks at these types of things?
Well, again, I think that's right. The principle behind what Bunny was doing certainly is a valid one. But as I said earlier, this was a lightning rod of a topic to stay away from in a down economy. As I kind of jested apple pie and motherhood, sure. You don't argue against it.
Does anybody buy the argument that's been made by some or hinted at by others without wanting to come out and say it, that if you cut off people's benefits, they're more likely to go out and get a job?
That's very. This is one of these situations where it's very easy to follow the economic theory that extending benefits creates a situation where it's a disincentive. But politically, it's just unpalatable. In the same way that the stimulus package on paper, in theory, there's better ways to stimulate an economy, cut corporate taxes and cut income taxes. But again, it's politically unpalatable.
Yeah, understood. I think maybe the question for, you know, if the economic question then, Jim, is if we did it, just in a hypothetical sense, would that incentive be created for people to go get work, and then would they find it? In other words, is the economy ready to start hiring these people if they're out there looking? Are they looking and they're just not finding anything?
Well, I guess I will say that I still feel the jobless rate is understated. I think if the Labor Department actually starts to use what appears to be more comprehensive data, you're going to see there is actually greater job loss.
Well, you look at that U6 number and see it's up in the 17% range, is that where it is now still?
Under 17, I think.
Yeah, a little bit under 16 something.
No, I don't think the jobs are there. I think that's the other. It's not that these people don't want to go out and work. At the end of the day, they do.
They're looking and they can't find
work. But I don't think there's much don't mean to be cynic about this, but politically, there's not much a government or Congress can do about it. You have to let the economic cycle play out. There was extreme over-leveraging. There was excess capacity. That takes time to wind out the economy. Some things can bring forward consumption a little bit, maybe by a quarter. But ultimately, the cycle has to play out, and it's a painful, long process.
As it has been for the last couple of years, really. All right, Jim and Mike, thanks a lot for that. We're going to move on here.